In this module, we're going to talk about how salts can act as an acid or a base. And remember, when we say salt, we just mean an ionic compound. Sure, sodium chloride is the common, you know, table salt, but potassium cyanide, for example, is an ionic compound. That's a salt, too. So how can this happen? Well, it happens through what's called salt hydrolysis. And what this means is that if you take an ionic compound, a salt, that's a strong electrolyte, and you dissolve it into water, if the anion part of that ionic compound is the conjugate base of a weak acid, or this can happen too, if the cation is the conjugate acid of a weak base, and I'll show you that in just a little bit, then you get what's called hydrolysis, and hydrolysis will affect the pH. Well, hydrolysis means breaking apart of water. And what happens is, if the anion of the ionic compound is the conjugate base of a weak acid, then it's going to act as a base in water, and it's going to accept a proton from water. For example, let's say we made a 0.150 molar solution of potassium fluoride. Potassium fluoride is a strong electrolyte, it's soluble, so it dissociates into the potassium ion and the fluoride ion. The fluoride ion will do this, it'll react with water. It'll accept a proton, forming the hydrofluoric acid molecule and hydroxide. The hydroxide is what changes the pH of the solution compared to what it was before we put the salt in. So let's calculate the pH of this solution. And you need to know the Ka for hydrofluoric acid is 7.1 times 10 to the minus 4th. Well, I mean, that's what you usually get, the Ka. But in this case, this reaction here, what's happening, the chemistry that's going on, describes exactly what the definition of KB. And so we need really to set up our ice table, which is what we're going to do. We need to know KB, but that's easy because remember, Ka times KB is equal to Kw, where Ka is the K is for a weak acid, and KB is for the conjugate base of that acid, which is the situation here. So we know Ka for hydrofluoric acid. We can find KB for fluoride by taking Kw over Ka. When we do that, we get 1.4 times 10 to the minus 11th. Now that we know Kb, we can set up our ice table. So let's do that. So there it is, your normal ice table. We made a 0.150 molar solution of potassium fluoride. That's where this came from. Now, we don't have any of this yet, but look at here. We have about zero, but it's not exactly zero, is it? Because we have the autoionization of water producing some hydroxide, 1 times 10 to the minus 7th molar at 25 Celsius. So, but let's try neglecting that and just saying it's about zero at first. I'm not sure I'd, you know, really comfortable with that, but let's see what happens. The reason I'm not that comfortable is a small KB like this, we're not going to get much, so it might be on the order of 1 times 10 to the minus 7th. Let's see what happens. Well, set up our Kb expression, get x squared over 0.150 minus x. Now I am confident that x is going to be a lot smaller than 0.150 because of the small size of the Kb. So let's neglect the x, compared to 0.150 that is, and solve for x, and we get about 1.5 times 10 to the minus 6. Well, first of all, yes, that's definitely way less than 5% of 0.150, so this was a good approximation down here. But what about the hydroxide ion concentration from the autoionization of water? Well, 1.5 times 10 to the minus 6, it's pretty close. It's more than, 10% of 1 times 10 to the minus 7th. Or it's 1.0 times 10 to the minus 7th is almost 10% of this, rather. So let's go, and we could probably get away with this. It's not that different. But let's go see what happens when we throw in the hydroxide from the autoionization of water, 1 times 10 to the minus 7th. No big deal. You can do this. It's a nice table. So we get these equilibrium concentrations. There's our equilibrium expression. Now we're going to get a quadratic because of this term up here. We're not going to be able to do without that, but that's no big deal. Go ahead and solve your quadratic. When I solve this quadratic equation that results from here, I got these two roots for x. We can throw this guy out right away because it's negative, and we're left with 1.4 times 10 to the minus 6. Is that significantly different than what we got neglecting this? Well, 1.4 to 1.5. not that much different, but there you go. Now, okay, we want to find the pH. So that means we need to know the hydroxide ion concentration, which is going to be 1 times 10 to the minus 7th plus this, plus x. So when we add them together, get 1.5 times 10 to the minus 6th. To get the pH, I'm going to take the negative log base 10 of the hydrogen ion concentration. So the way I'm going to do it is I'm going to use Kw to get the hydrogen ion concentration, knowing the hydroxide ion concentration. I take Kw over the hydroxide ion concentration, and I get 6.6 times 10 to the minus 9th molar for my hydrogen ion concentration. Take the negative log base 10 of that, and we get our pH, 8.18. There you go. Right, now, cations. How can cations affect the pH of a solution? Well, some, the ones that are small and highly charged, can associate with water molecules and actually help another water molecule to pull off a proton, meaning that they're acidic. Now, to do that, the metal ion has to be pretty small and highly charged. Highly charged means most of the time plus 3. With something really small like beryllium, plus 2 will do it too. So for example, with aluminum in water, this equation describes what happens. Water molecules associate with the aluminum ion, and another water molecule comes along and pulls off protons from one of these guys. I'm going to show you that in a minute. But the Ka for this is 1.3 times 10 to the minus 5th. It's not that small. It's appreciable. So here's what happens. So this would be the aluminum ion right here. These would be the six water molecules that are associated with it. The positive 3 charge on this aluminum atom pulls electrons away from the oxygen, which pulls them away from the hydrogens. Now that hydrogen, the bond between the oxygen and the hydrogen is weaker, and that hydrogen has a more of a partial positive charge developing on it. So when another water molecule comes along, it's going to orient itself with the oxygen pointing towards one of these hydrogens, and it's actually strong enough to pull it away, forming the hydronium ion. And what we get over here now is the aluminum ion with 5 water molecules and a hydroxide with positive 2 charge and hydronium or H+. What if you have a salt where the cation and the anion both hydrolyze aluminum fluoride, something like that? Well, what happens is, okay, you can tell just by looking at the Ka for the cation and the Kb for the anion, whether or not this resulting solution will be acidic, basic, or neutral. Basically, if the Ka is bigger than the Kb of the anion, it's acidic. If the Kb of the anion is bigger than the Ka of the cation, it's going to be basic. And if they're about the same, it's going to be roughly neutral.